Hello, and welcome to the April edition of the Columbus Report, Waycross Community Media's government access program, giving the information from the State House to your house here at the Roundtable. I'm Jason Grisgore, joined by Mr. Jonathan Deaver of the 28th District.
How are you? Great to see you again.
Good seeing you as always. How's the 28th District been treating you?
Always well.
Good. As we were talking earlier, you went from point to point today.
I did, yes.
As we said, it was all standing.
Pretty much. Every time I come here, I get to travel the entire district from corner to corner.
And like I said, it's still standing, and yeah, we're still in good condition.
Indeed. Yes, sir.
Usually as spring begins, the governor does one of his infamous things, and that is to stand up in front of everybody and talk, that being the State of the State address.
Correct.
That was this past Tuesday, April 4th, in Sandusky. Not riding any roller coasters this time, but discussing these what has happened and where we're going. You were in attendance?
I was. I always like to say, though, anytime you do a State of the State, regardless of who the governor is, it's a roller coaster. So you don't have to be in Sandusky or not.
So it was fitting.
I think so, in some respects, yes. Except for those of us from Hamilton County, it was a pretty good four-hour drive up and back on the same day. So,
fair.
But that's quite all right. So the State of the State, pretty very standard stuff that we've heard from the governor since he's been in office. His approach, he wants to eliminate the income tax. He wants to do some tax shifting and then spend some money in specific areas. And his speech hasn't deviated that much. It's been pretty consistent for the last several speeches that he's given, and I would assume that it'll sound similar next year as well.
It did go, like you said, very, very much like what we've heard before, what we've seen before, but we're seeing different upticks. And as we go through, I mean, one of the main things, of course, is we've talked here, he hit jobs and the economy right away, and that is important here. But we're seeing that movement and the momentum in what I dare say the first two things that he mentioned was aviation and automotive, which is kind of like the backbone for us anyway. Was that not almost we kind of knew that?
Well, I think when we're looking broad picture, when we're talking about economic development and job growth and those types of things, nationally, we haven't had really any kind of significant economic growth in a long period of time. I mean, when we're talking about 1.5% and people get excited, they'll forget when we grew up and it was 4 to 7%,
right,
in any given quarter. So the reality of it is we are not growing at the rates that we need to be growing, specifically in the emerging economies and sectors. I think one of the things the governor hit on that's actually quite real, and we've seen it in our lifetime, is the changing economy and how that's going to impact the workforce. He mentioned the autonomous cars. I know we were briefly talking about that before we started, but there is going to be a day where those types of things are going to be a reality, where you walk outside, your car is linked in somehow to a network, and it's going to drive you, and you're not going to have to drive. So the productivity times that we're used to now will be completely different. We'll be expected to be working in our cars, probably.
Correct.
Right?
I was going to say.
So we're not even going to get that real true downtime, which
exactly.
Isn't really downtime anyway, because you're talking on the phone. So I think that's going to change a lot of that, and that's going to change the conversations we have about public transportation, what that looks like. The statistic that he used when he talked about, at any given time, you're only using your car 10%
of
its ownership.
Yeah.
Well, mine's sitting outside for an hour, so theoretically I could send it off and let someone get a ride to and from while we're sitting in here, correct?
Fair.
So there is that as well, or, I take myself to work and then my car can be used later in the day. So I think that will change the way we look at things like Uber and Lyft and the way we deal with transportation infrastructure moving forward. That's going to be a big conversation, and the reality of it is we've been woefully underfunded in the transportation piece anyway. Our roads and bridges are not where they need to be.
Which is where it goes into that infrastructure discussion.
Correct. And so we've got a president who's promised a $1 trillion package to go around the country. Ohio really needs to do something to deal with our corridors going up and down. I mean, 8% of our goods and services in the whole country, our GDP, goes right across this river.
Exactly.
And so we need to be paying attention to this region geographically for not only that, but we've got a lot of technology. We're a donor county to the treasurer. We're one of the larger donor counties. I think we're the largest donor county to the state treasury. So it's time for us to get a little bit of our investment back.
He started with the major two, but he also led into, we're now getting into the tech and medical.
True.
It almost made it sound like, we're toeing the line. We're finally getting there. And
Yeah, I know. I think part of it is, you know, one of the things that I worry about as a representative when I'm looking at long-term growth and impact is that I don't want our state economy to get too lopsided in one sector or another. Well, we've learned.
Well, I think that's what we've seen, like I said earlier, with the aviation and automotive. That's our backbone.
Correct.
I get that. But I think, as you're saying, we have relied on it a little bit too.
Well, and we're now pushing more towards healthcare and relying on that. I mean, if you look at our total spend as a percentage of our GDP, what we generate and what we're actually spending as a state, more than half of our budget goes to healthcare costs. So we're over at 53% of every dollar we spend as a state government goes to healthcare costs. It's not a very sustainable model.
Right.
When we look at, you know, total manufacturing for healthcare and healthcare itself, it's, you know, it's pushing 30% of our total GDP as a state. So that's really highly weighed in that sector. So I think part of the conversation needs to be, you know, again, the things that we were discussing in the last, you know, last couple of years was how do we create a business environment, a corporate tax structure, and a corporation structure just legally to let people start and develop their businesses here and or come and relocate here. We don't have a beach and we don't have a mountain.
We
do have a lake and we have a river and they're nice, but we don't have a warm climate and some of those other variables. So the only thing that we can really do is provide that economic environment, which I believe is solid, but give them some, you know, a little bit more of incentive to come here to experiment and try things out. And what that'll do is keep our talent here, because a lot of these folks that are leading the way nationally are coming from our state and we're losing them. So that's what we need to do is keep them here. I would argue that some of our public schools are even here in this area, and our private schools are some of the best in the country. We definitely are a center of you know, innovation and creativity, so we need to bring them back.
We definitely are in that regards, especially when it comes to schooling, because we're looking at different school funding as well as school models,
right.
Especially Winton Woods itself being a new tech project-based learning type of facility now. And then, of course, we do have different ideas of how we want to teach and how they should not be in a classroom and things like that. That's, you know, we're doing a lot of modeling here, which is a great movement. We were it's still in that job and economic, you know, you had said, you know, we don't have a mountain, we don't have a the beach or anything like that. We do have four seasons, or at least when they try to make four seasons. We try to have
this week we've had all four.
We did.
Right.
That is true. That is funny, because I did feel like I smelled like, oh wow, it did smell like fall today.
Yeah.
But not today. But what we are seeing is that uptick, because we are now training a bit more. We have gone from what was the 38th in business to the 11th best state.
Mm-hmm.
That is probably one of the best things coming out of this whole discussion,
right,
is that we're actually moving forward. Are we a little more leery that we may sit on those laurels and let it slip back again?
I can tell you no.
I
don't think from, at least under the current leadership, so our speaker and our Senate president and our governor and our statewide office holders are relatively united on this process and what we want to see Ohio become.
Mm-hmm.
And our whole goal, I've been saying this since the first time we sat down here, is we need to be a leader in innovation and technology, be the place where everybody wants to come and do business. And part of that is, you know, is dealing with the infrastructure needs that we have. And the other part of it is investing in the right types of businesses and reaching out, which I believe the governor's administration has done a very, very good job in that regard. The data speaks for itself. I mean, you just cited the statistics. And then changing the tax climate, making things more, you know, simple and effective. Secretary of State is an example. You can start a business now for $99, and it's instantaneous rather than waiting 3-4 weeks to get a piece of paper. I mean, all of those little simple barriers that are in the way, those bureaucratic red tape pieces, are slowly coming down in a way that's meaningful and impactful to small businesses, let alone the big ones.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, if you've got a little small mom and pop, coffee shop down here in one of the malls, our climate is friendly for you as well as Procter & Gamble.
Are you not seeing that this is almost, as we kind of looked at this and our conversation here, is it not modeling or mimicking the federal model right now? That we're hearing a lot of that. We want to remove these things to make things easier for you. We want to do that. Not that the governor is trying to do that, but do you feel that there is a possibility of a, well, that makes a little more sense here or there?
Well, I think at the federal level, we had a totally different administration, a totally different way of doing things. In Ohio, we've been doing things a little bit more conservative and a little bit more thoughtful from the way we view things, right? So I think you have different folks in those capacities. I think the president is looking at taking some of those cues from Reagan, which was the first step, was I'm going to deregulate as much as I can and get out of the way.
Right.
You know, and then we're going to do some through the CRA process, which is so far seems to be working, and then start chipping away at tax policy and reducing the cost of healthcare and those types of things at the federal level. I think the big problem that we have as a state long term is dealing with the cost of care. And part of that means we have to partner with the administration in order to find those ways that work. We do know that what we got in 2008 is not working. The cost of care is going up. Your average, you know, when I was in college, my health care, when I was 18 years old, it was $50. That was it, a month. And it was major medical. My deductible was $1,000, but it covered big things. You know, I didn't cover everything.
You weren't worried, really.
Right. I wasn't worried, and it wasn't a problem for me. And I think most Americans felt that way. You know, the three things that the federal government has gotten involved in over the last 30 years, real estate, well, we know how that worked out.
Yeah, that worked out well.
You know, student loans, we know that's getting ready to pop. And then healthcare, those three sectors have inflated astronomically to the point where your average working person can't, you know, not only have their house, but buy a new car every other year and put them in the car and take them down to Florida for vacation on spring break.
Right.
I mean, the average family can't do those things because those costs are so out of control, and those are things that you got to have. You have to have an education, you have to have a house, and you got to have some health care.
Right.
And those are the three things that the federal government got involved in, and it costs more. Every time you take a dollar out of our community and send it to Washington, to send it to Columbus to give it back to us, everybody's taking a piece of it. Whereas if we just kept the dollars right here and let our little local officials take care of it,
mm-hmm.
or let the folks in Columbus take care of the things that they should be taking care of, the costs would be reduced dramatically. So what works here in Ohio is not going to work in Texas. It's not going to work in California.
Correct.
Actually, what works in Wynton Woods school system is not going to work in Princeton. I mean, they're next door to each
exactly.
other.
Exactly.
So I think that's the mindset that we have to have moving forward.
You brought up the idea of the healthcare and Medicaid was it, and you know the healthcare, that Medicaid expansion bought 700,000 people care mm-hmm. when we first did it. Obviously, things are going to probably be shifting again. Are we afraid of that?
Well, from a state perspective, the policy approach that we're taking is we're dealing with what's right in front of us. Anytime there's a new administration, whether regardless of how the election would have turned out, you're going to have a different approach to healthcare and policy, and something was going to change regardless.
Right.
So when when Secretary Clinton was running versus President Trump, they both had a different perspective, but they were going to make a change regardless. So that means that as a legislature, we're going to have to respond to those changes.
And I think it was also brought to us that we knew this wasn't the right model that it was going to be moving. I believe when it was brought to us,
both of them were saying that
correct.
About a year ago that both of them felt that there were things. Structurally broken and that they needed to make adjustments to the law. I think what the question, though, everybody's wondering is what is Ohio going to do? And quite frankly, we have to deal with what's in front of us. So the law is what the law is today.
Mm-hmm.
We're in the budget process right now. We're moving forward through that budget process based on what the law is, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there's a reason why they call it the Ohio Revised Code, right? So you
so
revise
you
it,
rate.
Right?
Yes.
We make the changes. So assuming that there is a change at the federal level, then, of course, we'll be ready to go and we'll make the adjustments. The big issue is going to be how those federal dollars are allocated. I know there's a big push from what we would like to see is a block grant so we can spend them as we think's right for the people of the state of Ohio,
mm-hmm.
instead of somebody in D.C. telling us how to spend the money when probably that individual's never been here.
I was going to say, they probably never set foot or understood the great dichotomy that we have in this state. We've talked about it many times. You know, what works in the southern tip does not work in the northern
correct.
Half.
And
that's just the way it is.
That's right.
You are watching the Columbus Report here on Waycross Community Media. We are still discussing the State of the State address with Representative Jonathan Deaver of the 28th District. We touched on it. Infrastructure is the big buzzword federally. Mm-hmm. It's also a big buzzword here because, as we already mentioned, we've got two major corridors, be it water and land, but we also have highways that intersect and bisect and go everywhere, that if something goes wrong any further, it could really cripple us. Maybe not necessarily in infrastructure, but he always used the word artery. We are a heavy artery for many, many things. We mentioned a little bit about the smart highways or the smart mobility corridors. It kind of goes in with House Bill 26, which is the state transportation budget, which you have voted for. It really reaffirms what the governor really wants is this that whole let's make sure everything's okay. I mean, granted, Northern 75, now that they've finished, that is absolutely wonderful. And it's great to drive
through.
It's just
time to, it's time to
it's
come,
time
down,
to
here.
Come yeah, down here right. a little that's bit. Right. That's I mean, right. we have seen some great changes down on 75, but there's many of us who still get agitated.
Yeah, I'm fortunate I don't have to drive that every single day. But,
good.
So, yeah, I'm on the other side of that. But, no, I think the there is a reality where we need to start prioritizing the southwestern part of the state. We've been ignored for a while. Just be honest. If you go from Columbus, if you go to southeast Ohio, the roads are wonderful. There's
correct.
Not a single pothole. If you go east or west, you know, you go out of Columbus east or west, roads are perfect, three lanes, perfectly paved, not a pothole. Go from Columbus to Cleveland. It's perfect. All the bridges in Cleveland have been rebuilt, or they're finishing up those projects right now. And you know, the one major project that we did have down in this region was the Jeremiah Morrow Bridge, which they've just completed.
Correct.
But it's time to resurface and get our three lanes now that that bridge is done from here all the way up to Columbus. That would be a priority on 71. 75, we still have some expansion, but that is actually in track and in process, so we will see that finishing up and moving further north to connect up in this way and further north into the Butler County area. So once that project's done, that 75 corridor will be cleaned up, fortunately, in a way that will help us facilitate and move traffic. But the 275 is still a challenge, especially when you're coming over from the Claremont County area over to here during certain times of the day.
Yes.
It's not worth getting on. So we're looking at some soft shoulder runs and reducing the speed limit to open that up. That should add basically an extra lane to two lanes of traffic, so that way we can move those sort of like the sort of buses can run on the
go
shoulder.
On this, right?
Yep. So they're experimenting not only at 670, but there's also a proposal with ODOT to experiment on this 275 loop between the Claremont County exits all the way through and basically over to here to give that soft shoulder run to free up the traffic during certain times of the day. But the big issues that we still have are those congestions downtown and how are we going to reallocate and move traffic. There is a conversation about another bypass highway, which no matter what, does not solve the Brent Spence issue.
No.
So you would be paying, $2 billion for two things instead of one thing and being done. So there's great conversations about that. And, I think one of the most interesting conversations is make 71 go down over 471 and connect on the southern part and alleviate the 71 traffic and connect it south into Kentucky and then allow 75 to be more of a 75 corridor and 50 is just 50. So, we put a park over it or something, finish up putting the rest of the overpass on it and turn it into a nice park for the city.
What an interesting way to look at that.
Yeah.
As you said, everybody else got their fair share. And not that we haven't been seeing movement, but why do you think our region has been so easily ignored, so to speak, considering the connections that we have? We're three states right away.
Right. Right. Well, I think largely it has to do with leadership from the region. So if you look further north, most of the speakers of the House have been from the north or from the east or the west of Columbus. They haven't been from down here.
Okay.
Most of the appropriation bills, so that's why they call it House Bill 26. The transportation budget originates in the House. So if you kind of pay attention to who's been in charge and who the governors are and where they geographically come from, I'm not saying that they're picking on a particular region, but it seems to be the way they drive home is very nice. So I think part of that is regional leadership. Southwest Ohio has not had, Cliff Rosenberg is the first speaker from the region in decades, and Hamilton County hasn't had one specifically since 1952. So when you're looking at somebody who would have been in charge of prioritizing future projects, that comes out of leadership in the
right.
House. So I think that's part of it because those dollars get allocated there. The other side of it, too, is we have not had any major infrastructure spending at the federal level in 16 years. We had a lot of promises when the Obama administration came in, talked about shovel-ready jobs.
Correct.
But the problem is that nothing's technically shovel-ready, even though something's in track, because it's a long process. Some of these highway projects can take 8 to 10 years because of the environmentals and all the other concerns and the rights of way that have to be attained. It takes a long time to jump through the regulations that are in place at the state and the federal level in order to actually do something. So,
and you also have, as we said earlier, we have four seasons.
Correct.
We have a
That's
limited
right.
time frame.
That's right. And the other part of where we live geographically is that we have a unique challenge because of the type of four-season weather we have. We don't have a solid freeze. We have freeze-thaws all the time, which is very, very difficult to build on. So you go to Columbus, you can build a road in up there or in Cleveland, and it's going to last longer than it does down here, specifically because we have that freeze-thaw or weather changes so much that it's a challenge from an engineering perspective to build something that lasts.
It is scary, but we have to make things happen. And like you said, this bill is still in Senate as of March, so mm-hmm. it's still being looked at.
The transportation bill is all the way done.
It is all the way done now.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, they need to update their website then.
Yeah.
But going back a little bit to this smart mobility corridor, obviously the test subjects are possibly up in 670 and 33 closer to Dublin, and then I-90 in Cleveland. Any reason why? I mean, obviously the Columbus one is a no-brainer. I think that's a no-brainer. But there are other larger cities. I mean, Dayton, maybe not the largest, but I mean it's still got an area that you can play with, so to speak.
I think part of the considerations too, if you look, Columbus was named as one of the tech cities in the country, so
sure.
It has the basic infrastructure right now to begin the process. So I mean, you have to think about the. You know, you have to be 5G. You have to have the CAT and the broadband and the backup systems to make sure that the last thing you want is an autonomous car and the system shutting down because somebody hacked it or
right.
because you didn't have enough internet connectivity or enough bandwidth to make it work. So I think part of that is, you know, these are limited places that aren't very long, very, very narrow to try and bring in people to experiment to see what they can do. And so that was kind of the reason is they're ready to go and we're not. So
sure.
if we were going to do that, it would take us several years to get to the point where you could actually start something like that. I'm just happy that they're doing it in Ohio in general. I mean, clearly, I think we've got some talent right over here in Evendale specifically.
Fair.
That could participate in that process. And so I've encouraged them to work with the administration to see if they can get some of those jobs, even if it means people commute a little bit, but at least some of the engineering and the architecture and some of the brain power that goes behind the software could happen right down here in our area.
Well, and that's kind of where I was leading, is the fact that we have spoken many times that we have some great talent here, that we have small pockets similar to mm-hmm. this that we could have played with, that our hands could have been in the toy box, too.
Sure.
Being able to, I don't want to say outsource, but be able to say, hey, we do have people, let's join in the party. I think that's a great handshake, at least a start,
right.
that may bring us.
And that's the idea, is connecting the talent that we have here with those projects. I mean, you know, you have to realize, too, that you know, it's a Columbus, you know, the president's a little bit further north. The governor lives right there. And
sure.
Right next to it. So, and I think the governor's really the one that's kind of moving this in the direction where he wants to see if Ohio can become the leader. And so it's kind of right in his backyard with his staff, his administration, who can monitor it. So I think there's some logistical reasons that make sense to do the experiment there. As a reminder, this isn't like, you know, 50 miles of road. This is a small stretch.
No.
So people can come in and experiment in a safe environment and do modeling and testing and, you know, test the cars, test the software. We don't want people testing software on I-75.
No.
Right? So we need to have a kind of a safe environment where we can do that. And everything down here is pretty much used. So we don't have areas where we can block things off and experiment with it as much. I mean, our corridors are for commerce and for moving people and goods and services. And that's what our system has been designed to do. And, you know, Columbus is a cow town. They've got a lot of roads up there that they could shut down and do things like that and easily take and do that. I think the experiment having that happen here in Ohio is a wonderful thing. It's a great step.
Mm-hmm.
And since they have that grant from the federal government to do this type of stuff, it's wonderful. Let them experiment, and then hopefully it works. And if it does, then we can start applying it to some of our routes down here to make things a little bit more efficient.
Where are we when we want to become this, you know, innovator and everything? Where are we in comparison to other states when it comes to something like this?
I think it's all in the experimental stage right now.
Okay.
So, you know, no state technically has this right. You know, this
sure.
is all
no,
experimental. It's kind of like, you know, the solar panels that are going to be coming out here in a couple days by, you know, Mr. Tusk, you know, he's created a solar panel to replace your shingles, and they're just shingles.
Yep.
Right, and you can take a hammer and smack it, and it doesn't break, and it adds an R4 to your roof. And theoretically, if you shingle your whole house with this, the replacement cost is the same as a 50-year dimensional, is what I understand. but it also offsets your utility bill. So, I mean, if that works in Ohio, I mean, talk about a game changer from the perspective of, you know, mom and pop small businesses, but just your homeowner bill. I mean, if you can get your electric bill down to $20 a month, you'd be doing backflips right here on TV, right? So just for the cost of a new roof. So I think as, you know, as we're moving forward into the next 10 to 20 years, specifically if we start seeing you know, our federal government invest in you know, the concepts of going off into explore space again and going back to the moon and doing those types of things, you're going to see technology jump at leaps and bounds that have never happened before. And the private sector is now, you know, you've got a guy who's spending $1 billion a year of his own money to do, you know, space exploration for folks like you and I who want to go. So, I mean, that type of stuff is unique, it's interesting, and it's going to lend itself to a lot of development and creativity. And our region right here, you know, we create engines and superconductors, and we do all the software and the, you know, for the F-35s and the cockpits, you know, all those components. So I think as those industries expand, we're going to be in a great place. The key, of course, and all that is we got to get our kids educated to take those jobs, and so they stay here.
Right.
So, you know, the old concept of muscle jobs and factory jobs are going to go away, and this is going to be the new technology. So our kids, when they're going through high school and grade school right now, or, you know, right here in our district, that's why education is, in my mind, one of the most important things that we need to talk about locally, and making sure that those kids have the skills that they need to think critically. You know, filling in a bubble sheet's great and fine and dandy, but if you can't think critically and think outside the box, those jobs are not going to be available to you. So we need to really encourage that type of education. So these folks around here that have these businesses have some folks that they can hire so that we can get the work done.
Unfortunately, real life does not include filling in bubbles, because if it were, jobs would be a lot easier.
Well, this isn't a fill-in-the-bubble moment either.
No, not at all. Of course, going into one of the items that we talk heavily about is schools. Schools were mentioned within the state of the state. Do you feel that Governor Kasich is definitely kind of put that emphasis out there, that schools need to be looked at? I mean, we've talked about the changing models and the fundings and things like that.
Well, I think we've had this conversation many times, but, you know, when we made a decision as a society to move into the cities and get into manufacturing and the Industrial Revolution, you know, we made a decision to stop teaching people one-on-one. So that's kind of the ironic part. The finest institutions in the world still do a tutorial process where, you know, they talk one across, you know, and they have a piece of paper like this and a pen or a pencil, and you do your math and your comprehension and your reading, and everything's done physically, mentally, and they're challenging one another Socratically. And that leads us to have some of the finest minds come out of those institutions. However, we switched the way we educate, so we put kids into an assembly line like we're building a car. And we're expecting, you know, that one bolt that will fit on a bolt that's designed to hit a certain place on a specific car to fit every time. But everybody learns differently. We're all different. We have different DNA. We all are all different height, different weight. We all look different, have different DNA, a different blood type. We're all different. So how can you create an educational environment that's, you know, one size fits all? It does not work. We know that. But what we have not done is we have not changed that. Now, we tinker with it, and we like to talk about it, and we say it's about money, or we say it's about this, or we say it's about that. But what we have not done is accept the fact that the best way to teach is to the individual, right? Mm-hmm. And we have not accepted that as policy makers. We have not accepted that as educators. I think if you talk to teachers one-on-one, they will agree with that, and that's what they want. They want to get to a smaller group size, and they want to do that one-on-one time. And they will tell you that when their group size is small and they have one-on-one time and they don't have superintendents, state boards, you know, politicians telling them how to educate kids, the results are better. There's a reason why homeschool kids do 96% on the tests on average. Well, why is that? It's because they have the one-on-one time.
Right.
That's why. And we've gotten away from that model. And so when we talk about all these different things, the technology, kids are going to learn. They're going to learn it. They're going to pick it up. Mm-hmm. I mean, my two-year-old knew how to work a DVD player. The first time he touched it, he just was messing with it and had something playing when he was two.
See.
And I didn't teach him how to do it. He just figured it out. It's intuitive, right? So I didn't have to teach him that. Well, I mean, either that or I'm really going to be a happy dad someday. But I think that, you know, we're so focused on the technology that we're forgetting about also the basics, the math, the reading, the comprehension, the critical thinking, the things that actually matter. The technology can be a great resource and tool. But if you can't do the calculus and you have to have your computer, then how good of an engineer are you really going to be?
Right.
Right. So you need to be able to do the calculus in your head if you're going to be an engineer. You can't rely on some sort of toy or instrument or calculator or computer program. You need to be able to actually do it so you can take your product to a whole another level. And I think that's something that we're still struggling with.
And it's scary to think that, back in when we were being taught that it was, well, you can't bring a calculator. Don't you dare think about it.
Right.
You know, nowadays it's like, well, don't bring your phone in because information is everywhere now.
Right.
And I think, as you said, people rely on the extraneous than things that are rote memory to what are rote memory to us.
Right.
And I think we lose a lot of that. I'm hoping that, again, as we're seeing these changes in format and teaching models, that maybe we'll finally realize that there is that spark that makes that one-on-one a reality to make things work. Now, of course, the hard part is always the funding aspect of that.
Well, the funding's there. So, I know that we always have this argument every 2 years that, oh, there's not enough money in education. Oh, woe is us. But it's not really an accurate statement. What people end up fighting over are the funding source, not the total dollars. So, and every time you hear an argument that we got a cut, it's typically because the funding source for that one is gone, but it's been replaced by another source.
Right.
So you're talking about different sources, but I always laugh as a business person. You know, do you want to have 100 people giving you a dollar or one person giving you $100? Because if the one person leaves, you're broke. But if you have 100 people giving you a dollar, one person leaves, you can manage because you've only lost 1%.
Right.
So I think that's really the arguments that we see. And so when people say that we've lost all this money, they really didn't, because the total amount of dollars on the table is either the same or slightly up. It's just they're talking about a source versus the total amount of dollars. So I think there's some disconnect there.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, every 2 years, we are talking about a funding formula. So
right.
And that's way too complicated, and it doesn't need to be complicated. You can't explain it to anybody in any way that makes any sense. And I think that's another change that I'm hopeful for from the federal government, from the new administration, is block granting that money to us instead of sending us 40 different types of funding algorithms that you have to plug into ours.
And this may work or may not work.
Right, and it's based on your this or that factor, this variable, this variable, and then you have to create this complicated funding formula to get the dollars back to the district so that they have the same amount of net dollars. So I think that's the big challenge. It'd be easier if we had federal match, state match, and then your local would be done. It's just three sources and that's it, instead of having all these little formulas embedded within, right?
So it's very utopian.
It is, but it isn't. It's just common sense.
It's just
basic common sense. But I understand how it got there. The question is, how do we start peeling back some of that bureaucracy to say that, well, you know, this... It's kind of like watching housing dollars go into communities. It's like, well, we have a grant for this for housing, but you have to be this type of individual with this type of income, with this type of children, with this type of location, and it has these strange variables. And then, okay, well, you can get a dollar, but you didn't fit the perfect box, and you're outside the ratio by a dollar or 50 cents, so you don't get anything. And then, so we have these weird formulas that we put in place to administer these funds and these resources. And then at the end of the day, you don't have any flexibility at the local level to make judgment calls on what's in the best interest of the community or the child or the individual that's asking for the assistance or the help, or even just for their basic investment in infrastructure or basic investment in what we need to make our local governments work.
And then, as we've seen, especially when the local government has been hit, how it has slowly affected everyone else now. And that's you and me.
Yeah, at the end of the day.
True. You're watching the Columbus Report here on Waycross Community Media. I'm with Jonathan Deaver, representative of the 28th District, discussing the final bits of the state of the state, and one that actually hit many things. We've talked about it, especially at the beginning of the year. We've talked to many individuals who are here at the roundtable. The drug problem that is still affecting us here in the state, as well as a nation, and as well as a region. There were many points in contention that he was talking about. As I go back to the artery, we are an artery. He made a great analogy. For a drug dealer, Mexico is a day away.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Chicago is 4 hours away.
That's
we
right.
are the pass-through to the unfortunate, and we need to make some changes now. And I think that's what he's looking towards to help the problem that we're facing today.
Yeah, there's two main components. Obviously, law and order. That's pretty straightforward.
With or without Jerry Orbach.
It's always a good one.
Yeah.
But the law and order, you know, that's one component, and there are many different philosophies on that. We've seen countries go to a complete legalization of everything and regulate it and tax it. You know, we've seen that model. I mean, our country's not going to go there, so that's kind of off the table. So we're kind of in that space where we have to make a decision on, we have to prioritize which folks we're going to be taking off the street and locking up. But part of that also is, you know, how do we reduce the amount of people we have incarcerated in the state of Ohio? You know, there's an argument that a vast majority of low-level offenders that are in there, meaning F4s, F5s that are in prison, are there because a judge violated them on a technicality on a probation, right? So they're on a post-release control or probation, and maybe they didn't show up to court with a suit and tie on. They just showed up in a button-down shirt, and so he violates them. And so there's things like that that occur all over the state, and you've got people serving time for nonviolent offenses right alongside violent offenders for technical little violations of their probation. So I think that's part of the conversation is who do we want to take off the street and why?
Mm-hmm.
But then on the other side, which I think is a bigger problem, is that we've had, we talk about treatment a lot, but nobody wants to face the fact that what we're doing isn't working. And everybody comes in and wants to be the person or has the idea to fix it all. And the reality of it is what we do know definitively is that if you focus on an individual, meaning a case plan, so when a person has an episode or they're addicted, there's a case plan developed around that person. And if you follow the case plan, the likelihood of success goes up. We also know that a typical person needs 3.7 times to go back into the system through that case plan in order to have a likelihood of success because this stuff is that addictive. But what happens is that everybody thinks that their little part of the case plan is more important than the case plan itself, so they fight for the money and they want more money. So I'll give you a prime example. You have Talbert and Cathouse who do great jobs on the treatment side, and they run the case plan. Well, there's no reason why do we need to replicate what Talbert and Kat are doing in 15 different locations around the county. That doesn't make a heck of a lot of sense. They're really good at what they do. But there are other groups that provide services that supplement and help fulfill the case plan, and they're very good at what they do. But now everybody wants to do what everybody else is doing instead of just being really good at what you do and being a specialist and providing services to the case plan. So the problem with the funding modeling is that everybody's being funded as though they're doing everything, even though they're really not. They're not capable of doing it. They don't have the bandwidth. They don't have the institutional knowledge. And so we need to let treatment folks do treatment things mm-hmm. and let it be a case plan and let the people who are working with that individual develop a treatment plan. And that case plan may be working with the jailhouse. It may be working with the court. It may be working with ODJFS. It may be working with the foster care system. It may be working with, you know, a kinship care process. Those are all things, but the kinship care is not treatment.
Right.
And foster care is not treatment. And the jailhouse is not a treatment center and a rehab center. And so all of these folks are all trying to do the same thing and fight over the same dollars. But at the end of the day, we only have so much money on the table. So what we need to be doing is looking at it in a whole new way and restructuring it from the standpoint that we know when we focus on a case plan that's person-centered, individual-centered, they can get the best treatment and best care possible, and then let everybody provide resources to work that case. And that may mean that they end up in jail again. That's okay. It may mean that. It may mean that that's what they need. It may mean that they need outplacement for their kids for a while in the foster care system. It may mean that they need some family members to take their kids for a while. So there's a lot of working parts there. And the challenge I think that we have is that everybody wants money. When they come to us, they say, well, you're not giving us enough money. You're not giving us enough money. You're not giving us enough money. We can't provide the treatment. We can't provide the detox. I'm like, well, why is the jail trying to do detox when we've got the Cat House, who's the only place in the entire region that's certified to
why
do it?
Why are they not going there?
Well, why aren't we sending them there to detox, and then we can send them back to the jailhouse, and we can work. You two can work together to provide the case plan and provide the addictive services that they need. But then we can work through the drug court to get these people back on their feet, get them employed, and get them back to work. So I think that's the challenge: is how do we how do we let everybody who's really good at what they do be good at what they do?
Are we becoming a society that's just too used to a one-stop shop that we think that, well, if I do this, well, then I have to do it all? And like
perhaps.
You said, rather than not perhaps. Letting them shine? Because
well, perhaps.
I mean, I completely agree with you. The fact that if you have a talent, this could go to a job, a place of business, an individual. If you do it, you do it well, don't you want to be known for that?
Well, I think so. I mean, we do it in medicine, right?
Right.
Mean, you go to the best, you have a heart problem, you go to the cardiologist, right?
Right.
You have a lung problem, you go to the pulmonologist, right? You have a cancer issue, you go to an oncologist. right? But it doesn't. The family doctor doesn't try to do all that. The guy that you go to that gives you your physical and diagnoses you, he doesn't do all of that. So in medicine, we don't do that. In law, we don't do that. As a lawyer, I do certain things, and things that I don't do on a day-to-day basis, I go get somebody that that's all they do, so that way you have the best possible care for that particular issue. We try to do that even in legislating, contrary to popular opinion. You know, we bring in the best and smartest people that are willing to come in to help educate us and advise us on how to move a policy in a direction that's going to be most beneficial to people. So I think the challenge that we have is just restructuring the mindset of how we deal with addiction. And look, in Hamilton County, we're lucky. I mean, when I travel the state, they don't have what we have here. I mean, we have a bunch of people who are working together, whether they're law enforcement, the judges downtown, the probation office, Cat House, Talbert House, Trippy down there at Mental Health Services. I mean, all of these people meet all the time in big groups and talk about how they can help folks. And we have it all right here. It's just a matter of getting them all on page to help, you know, to work together collaboratively. We do that with police and fire, right?
Correct.
We share fire engines. We share services there. So it's similar. It's a similar process, and I think we'll be able to get there. It's just changing the conversation a little bit.
Obviously, this is not something that happened overnight, and our end result will not happen overnight. But do you think that by year's end we may see better results?
Well, I think there's two things that are going on in Columbus. The first is that the speaker came out with something called the HOPES Initiative. So the HOPES Initiative is really meant to drill down on this and to help restructure it. Now, we're not going to have time during the budget to do it, so we're going to continue to fund things as we always have. Mm-hmm. But this process will be a committee. It'll be chaired by Bob Sprague. I'm on the committee. So we'll be traveling the state listening to all the little areas, the small little counties, the major metropolitan areas, trying to figure out what resources they do and don't have. Mm-hmm. And the concept is, again, that case plan, is looking at it from a case plan perspective and then seeing how we can craft policy to allow that to be a model. Now, what's going to work in Hamilton County is going to fail miserably just right here in Butler County. They don't have what we have. And you go out into southeastern Ohio, it's going to be miserable application if you try to go down to Gallier, Vinton, or Lawrence, or Meigs County, places like that, and say, hey, you have to follow a Cincinnati model. It's not possible. They don't have these institutions and these players that we're very fortunate to have. And we're also lucky to have them because we're ground zero. So we're extremely lucky that we have the treatment component. So that, I think that's the challenge. So you're going to see something coming out of the General Assembly from the House side sometime this year, but that traveling committee is going to begin right when we get done with budget, and we're going to be traveling the state through the summer and the fall to try to figure out how to restructure this and share those resources and get the best and the brightest people in every community to participate where they're strongest in that centralized case plan approach.
Well, it's a good way to look, again, focusing talents to make things work.
Correct.
One final thing in regards to the state of the state. You know, obviously, as we started this conversation, it's something we hear all the time. Do you think that this address made a difference or an impact to what we need to see moving forward for 2018, 2017, 2018, and beyond?
That's always a good question. I think everybody asks that every year, right? So the one thing I can tell you about the budget process is the governor always puts forward his proposals, and that's really what the state of the state was about, was his proposed budget. But what we've also seen in the last 6 years is that, albeit that he's our governor and we respect his objectives, we have sometimes different opinions on how to get there. And you will see a substitute bill coming out in a couple of weeks that are going to make some adjustments to what he wants to do. And I think you're going to see a lot of similar policy out of the last General Assembly. So the last 2 years in this budget moving forward. Remember, we have the same finance chairman, same speaker. And so we are not really interested as a caucus in doing that much shifting in any regard. Realistically, we've got, we have a tight budget. We're going to try to arrest some spending because we want to try to refocus some of those dollars into education into the HOPES Initiative, which is the heroin problem.
Right.
And so by doing any kind of expansion or any kind of shifting anywhere, it would negatively impact those objectives. Mm-hmm. So I think you're going to see an attempt to balance those, you know, what the governor would really like to try to do versus what the legislature really wants to try to do to be responsive at the local level for those two main issues.
Well, we shall see as things go on. kind of going forward, some bills and things and some, like I call them, bells and whistles that affect the 28th as well. Let's start with something really good, that you have been named co-chair of the Ohio Constitutional Modernization Committee.
It's a mouthful.
It is a mouthful, but it is actually something that seems right up your alley. For those who haven't had a chance to speak candidly with you, history and the knowledge that you have of Ohio and all around is amazing. So for you to be a part of the co-chair of this, congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
It is something that you're going to be able to study the Constitution that we have today and make some recommendations to the General Assembly of what needs to kind of modernize, be a little bit ahead of the time. Your thoughts on this appointmentship?
Well, the Speaker asked me to do it for a couple of different reasons. One, he wanted someone to kind of wrap this thing up and actually get some of these consensus items. So it's kind of funny. You have everybody agrees that there are certain areas that nobody likes, but nobody can agree on the language or the comma or the period, and there's a lot of infighting. And you have to have a supermajority of commission votes in order to get anything passed. So you have to have 22 votes in order to pass anything, right? And you have to pass it not once but twice in different committees, and then you have to come back in a couple of readings. But it's almost impossible to get anybody to vote, because the reality of it is we use these, you know, the Roberts rules, so you can abstain. So you have all these people abstaining because they don't want to take a position on anything. So what I've been kind of tasked to do is to reel in the process and get people to move something. And so my philosophy, quite simply, is that when you're looking at the Constitutional Modernization Commission, everything that they're recommending is subject to the will of the General Assembly. So if we send them language, the General Assembly doesn't have to follow it. They can propose their own language, and they probably will, because we have an army of lawyers. It's called LSC, Legislative Service Commission. And they're going to look at it, and they're going to say, well, you can't do that, and here's why. And so they're going to change the language, and then there would be a resolution that we would have to pass out of both chambers to put to the voters to vote on. So my approach is very, very simple. We all agree what's broken, and we all agree what needs to be taken out or what needs to be changed. As an example, we still call people with disabilities idiots in our Constitution. And we can't even get that out because there are certain members that say, well, if you're going to get that out, I want this. And it's like, we're not doing quid pro quos here.
Wow.
We're not changing. Yeah, they want to change the Constitution.
We're arguing over semantics that
right. So we can't agree on removing a word that's offensive.
Yes.
Because somebody else wants something thrown into the Constitution that's not there for their own constituents or their own, right? So you can't remove that. So my philosophy on this is very, very simple. We can't agree on language, fine. I don't care what the language is. Let's at least agree on the issue and tell the General Assembly and give them a list of items that they need to address. And let the General Assembly, Republicans and Democrats, and say that we need a Republican and a Democrat to run each resolution. So that way when a resolution goes on that issue, you get a Republican, you get a Democrat, they come together, bipartisan, they propose some language, the General Assembly votes on it, the Senate votes on it, and it goes out to the people to make the change. And that's kind of the process that I'm working under to try to make sure that the issues that we have consensus on that need to be changed are updated realistically, modernized, mm-hmm. right?
The modernization
come to fruition.
Sure.
A couple other issues that are out there. I mean, we have, remember when we did the casinos, we basically
yes.
have these properties that are in line, and there's one that's weird. It says, here's the property, but it has to be on the second floor of this building. And, well, what happens if you knock the building down? Then you can't have anything there. So it's things like that, like taking the meets and bounds out and moving it to the control commission and let the commission decide and issue license and those types of things. So there's weird things like that that get embedded in our Constitution.
Mm-hmm.
So those are the types of things that you'll be seeing going to the General Assembly, at least from my perspective, here's our list of recommendations. Do something with these, rather than trying to find 30 people. Out of 30 people, you got to get 22 to show up and vote in the affirmative instead of abstaining on words and language. And you can't get these people to agree on, you know, taking one word out and what word it should be. It's like person with a disability or this. No one can agree on what word it should be. So what's happened is that nothing's getting done. So that's why the Speaker put me as the co-chair, so I represent the House in this discussion, and the idea, at least from my perspective, is let's identify the issues, let's issue spot,
mm-hmm.
and let's send a report to the General Assembly and to the Governor and say these are the things we recommend that the General Assembly put before the voters.
Well, as much as it's very well needed, I think you're going to get that task done very well.
Well, we're hopeful.
We're hopeful.
We're hopeful. Yeah, we're hopeful.
Going through the last couple things, we did, the last time we had met, we did not get a chance to discuss this, but House Bill 40, mm-hmm. which was something that you proposed, for online tax expenditures, they need to be, it's a database.
That's correct.
That anybody can go on to. Adding to the transparency to the government that we have.
Last General Assembly, it was House Bill 46.
Yes.
And so this is the OhioCheckbook.com. So I'm sure by now most people have seen it. Last year we got our school system here in Winton was to go on.
Correct.
So we've been making some progress at the state and local level to get people to participate in this process. So it takes all of the local expenditures and all the state expenditures, so all the checks that are written by your public servants, you know, the treasurers and local folks,
yep.
putting it online so you can search and see how your money's being used. So what we wanted to do as a General Assembly is that the initiative started with Mike DeVilla, who was there before I, and he was kind of pushing this, and I had known him in that campaign. That was in the 2012 campaign, and I had an interest in providing transparency and accountability to the government. So when I got in, we teamed up right away and introduced House Bill 46. So the initial concept was we went to the governor, went to the treasurer's office, said, look, we want you guys to do this. We're going to pass a bill, but we want someone to do it. So they actually both, believe it or not, so the treasurer did it first. Now the OMB has done it, so the budget office has done it. So the budget office has put the budget stuff up, and the treasurer's put the checks he's actually written up. And so we're trying to actually get these two to figure out exactly what it is they're doing,
mm-hmm.
so that. But they're, of course, you know, each one wants some credit for what they've done,
sure.
and they both deserve credit. Josh has done a great job, and you know the director and the state's done a great job in his respect. So we're trying now to pass a bill that says that these databases have to be maintained by the next administrations.
Okay.
And the idea being is that because it was done by the treasurer, the checkbook bill, the next treasurer could come in and just forget to update it.
Okay, and now
accidentally
that
on purpose
Oops.
Of debt.
Yes
accidentally
yeah.
on purpose forget to update it, and same thing could happen in the budget office. And so what we want is we want those databases to stay online and to stay updated by the next administrations as they come in.
Do you think it's going to be met with a lot of opposition on that? Because, I mean, like you said,
yeah. Well, last,
administrations change.
Well, last term, the bill went through the House in 3 weeks, unanimously went out. I think about 60-70% of the House co-sponsored it, went to the Senate, had a couple of hearings, and then didn't get done. We were trying to get it done in the last in lame duck, but it didn't get done. Same thing had happened in the 130th General Assembly. So, you know, this General Assembly, we're starting out trying to get the two to compromise right out of the gate on which parts of that they want to cover, but I think the language that we have now, which is each one of you maintain what you have moving forward, is the right approach. So we'll see. Part of it is you have to get both offices to agree on the language that's being proposed before the bill can move forward. So I'm hopeful that the two will agree on the substitute bill that we have, and we'll have something for the public here shortly. So we'll see. I mean, transparency is key, and
it's been a key word, and
they've both done it. So
sure.
All we're talking about is a bill that is going to make sure that it doesn't go away, and that's really the purpose of the legislation.
More of a safety measure, so to speak.
Correct. Right.
Seatbelt. I like that. A bill that you've been working on, House Bill 56, mm-hmm. I know I hate to use this as the last one, but something that has really hit the area a little bit
yeah.
more, and for those who aren't aware, 56 is to expunge criminal records when caused by human trafficking.
Correct.
When people hear this term, I know probably a lot of things go through them, but how touched is Hamilton County in the 28th District touched by human trafficking, especially, and then of course when we go to
yeah.
the statewide?
Well, I mean, everybody that's kind of paid attention to some of the national TV shows, we've heard a lot about human trafficking, and we've done, on the criminal side, there's been some representatives, Therese Fetter up north has done some work on the criminal side of this, but the one piece that kind of breaks my heart personally, because it's dovetails in with the heroin work that we're doing. So a lot of these folks that are getting trafficked, just young girls, young boys, they're getting forced into these scenarios, and a lot of it's the gateway is a drug. So they bring them in, they shoot them up with heroin, and then they exploit and traffic these kids. And what happens over the course of this exploitation is they do get arrested occasionally, but they're also fearful and they're scared, and they don't know what to do or where to turn, and a lot of times they're belligerent about it because they're scared, and that's what they're doing.
Sure.
They pick up charges along the way. So, you know, get a drug possession, they get a solicitation charge, maybe a theft charge, whatever. So they pick up all these charges. And then sometimes, and eventually, these folks get out. All right, so you get out. You get clean, maybe the cat house grabs you, maybe Calvert grabs you, the cat house gets you through the drug court, and then you find out this person was trafficked, right? And you didn't know that initially, but now you found out they've been trafficked, and
right.
The day they get out, their pimp's on outside waiting with a needle.
To take them again.
With a needle, too, and we'll stick them and take them. And so part of what we want to try to do is, for these folks, when they do get out, what's the hardest thing to do when you get out? Get a job. The only way you can recover and get out is to have a job. And what's the one thing that people will do when they want to hire you? They do a background check.
Exactly.
And they see a drug charge and a solicitation charge, and then they don't get hired. So part of that's a big problem. And
mm-hmm.
And these are people who are victims of a crime. And granted, they've picked up some charges along the way, but we want to create, for the very first time, a path for them to ask the judge for an expungement and a sealing of those records. So once they've done what they need to do, whether it's drug treatment, whether there's something the judge needs them to do, you know, some therapy, some, you know, whatever it might be, whatever the judge says, but to give them a path to clean that up so they can get a job. Because if they can't get a job, the likelihood of them being trafficked again is exponentially great. So we were trying to provide a path for these people, these young boys, these young women, to get out of this cycle and give them a future.
Do you fear that... Pardon the term, do you feel that it may be something that could be exploited as well? You know, well, if you understand the system, then I can get out of it, and here we go.
Ah, but
again.
Alas, there's a process, and there's a hearing.
There we go.
So there's always a process there. So each judge will look at each offense, and each offense you have to prove, you actually have to prove, the individual has to prove that you were actually trafficked, and because you were trafficked, that's why you engage in those activities. So there is a process. There's a court process where the judge makes a fact determination on each individual offense.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not just a blanket, a pardon of everything
sure.
that
no,
you've
no,
done
no.
in your life. It's each offense. What did you do? You know, was it if you were solicitation's a little easy, right?
Right.
You know, maybe a drug offense might be a little bit more complicated. A theft offense might be a little bit more complicated, but if you can, you have to be able to present evidence, your lawyer does, to the judge, and if the judge agrees with what's been presented, then he has the right to expunge under this proposed statute. So it's fact by fact, case by case, individual by individual, and charge by charge. So this is not just a wholesale, if you can, you say that you were trafficked and then they wipe away everything that you've ever done in your life, it doesn't work that way. But at least gives a path.
A start
for,
to a path.
It gives a path for the very, very first time. For people who have been victimized. And quite frankly, if we're not doing that for people and we're expecting them to get a job and we're expecting them to not get back into that lifestyle, if you can't make a living, what they're going to fall back somehow.
Correct.
Right? And they're going to be easily victimized to fall back. So that's really what this is about, is trying to help those victims get an opportunity to have a new start in a life. And at the end of the day, we talk a lot about low-level criminal offenders expunging their records, right?
Right.
So why are we not taking people who've actually been victimized and giving them an opportunity to have a life?
And giving them their voice back,
absolutely.
So to speak.
Absolutely.
This is in committee currently, correct?
Yes, it is.
And we look forward to further conversation on that because this is definitely something we need to look at.
Yep.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your time. We
sure.
have made
Anytime.
It to the bottom of the hour. We will definitely reconvene in a few and discuss. There's been a lot to discuss, and of course there will always be more. So, Mr. Deaver, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Not a problem. Thank you. And I want to thank you for joining us as well. You've been watching The Columbus Road here on Waycross Community Media. I'm Jason Grisgorg, giving you the opportunity to chat with those from the State House to your house here on The Columbus Report. Have a great evening. We'll see you next time.